शास्त्रम प्रमाणन्ते टाइम टेस्टेड नॉलेज एकेडमिक प्रिंसिपल्स मेंशन इन द स्क्रिप्चर्स हेल्प अ पर्सन टू फाइंड आउट व्हाट इज वन्स ड्यूटी व्हाट इज व्हाट नॉट वन्स ड्यूटी राइट रॉन्ग इट इज एन एड इन डिसीजन मेकिंग सो तस्मात् शास्त्रम प्रमाणन्ते कार्याकार्य व्यवस्थितम् ज्ञात्वा शास्त्र विधान उत्तम हैविंग नोन कर्म कर्तुम् अर्हसि वन शुड एक्ट अकॉर्डिंग So the 17th chapter begins with this question of Arjuna. It's a question that anybody would have, and today's world especially a lot of people have. What is that question? Let us see. Om Shri Paramatmane Namaha. Atha Saptadasho Dhyayaha. अर्जुन उवाच ये शास्त्रविधिमुत्सृज्य यजन्ते श्रद्धयान्विताः तेषां निष्ठा तु का कृष्ण सत्त्वमाहो रजस्तमः So the question is, ये शास्त्र विधि मुत्सृज्य सपोज somebody doesn't know the scriptures, has not had the opportunity to learn, and has not come across the knowledge. But यजन्ते श्रद्धयान्विता with faith they act in the world. Here the word यजन्ते worship, but in a broader sense one can say that with faith one does the action. तेषां निष्ठा तु का कृष्ण वाट हैपेंस ऑफ सच पीपल सत्वमाह रजस्तमः इन दीज थ्री गुणास वेर डू दे फिट इन. सो देर आर थ्री कैटेगरीज बेस्ड ऑन दिस क्वेश्चन. देर आर थ्री टाइप्स ऑफ पीपल. फर्स्ट टाइप ऑफ पर्सन हु नोज द स्क्रिप्चर एंड हु एक्ट्स अकॉर्डिंग विद द स्क्रिप्चर विद फेथ. सी बोथ आर इम्पोर्टेंट. Permutations and combination, if you want to, there will be more categories. There are enough people who know the scriptures but act without faith. Just act mechanically or just become bound by the letter of the word, not by the spirit of that. There is one category of people who will just blindly follow what is written there, will not have that faith. So if it is written every day to Gayatri Mantra, they will get up and do Gayatri Mantra. And that Shraddha is not there, that there is one Lord or that there is a realization which can be attained through this path. No Shraddha. So one category of people who know the Shastra but no Shraddha. Second category of people who know the Shastra who have Shraddha also. They are the best people. Third category of people who don't know the Shastra. They don't know what is written, what are the injunctions, what are the do's, what are the don'ts. But they will do the action with faith. Faith in the higher way of life, faith in the Lord, faith in oneself. With best intention they will do the action. But they don't know the rules. Or they don't know what should be done, what should not be done. Inspired by their own intuition, guided by that, they do. And maybe somebody also tells them. Then the fourth category is, they neither know the Shastra nor they have faith, somehow they do something. All the four types of people. Question of Arjun here is of the third category. Because those who know the scripture, those who are following the injunctions and living accordingly, there is nothing to question. His question is, I don't know. I haven't learned. It's not that intentionally I am not following. I don't know. But I have faith. Is that fine? Today also many people ask that question. Now Puja Vidhi, simple example. They will not know what are the 16 steps, what is the shloka, what should be offered, what should not be offered, when to offer, when not to offer. So they, with their faith, they will do something. So is that fine? That's the question. See, this is not a license to not know the scriptures. This is not that forever one can reach that level where I don't know the scripture. At least now I have come to know that I don't know. And there is a possibility that I can find out and I can know. But till I come to understand, learn, if I am doing it with faith, then what is my Shraddha? Because earlier it was said that one should follow the scriptures, learn and then do the actions. Natva Shastra Vidhanamantra. This you can apply in any principle, any aspect of life also. There are people who will read the instruction manual and then operate the equipment. There are people who will not read, not interested, gut feeling. Just open and do something, put something somehow, what size you want. Sometimes it may misfire. Typically electric items one doesn't be careful of how many, what is the voltage it requires. And go and plug it somewhere, gets fused, burnt, anything happens. Then one learns the hard. Nowadays most common example is cell phone. Such advanced type of cell phones are available. Someone buys and gives it as a gift. Now this person is wondering which, what to press. One has to open the manual, read, then one will understand. But at some point, some age, you know, even inclination only is not there to open all that and learn. And half the people will not even use the advanced features of the phone. Basically one uses for communication some WhatsApp, some SMS. So the question here is that if I don't know the scripture, but I am acting out of faith, what is my condition? Now Bhagavan doesn't say that, okay, it is fine, you do. He takes this opportunity to explain what are the three types of faith. And according to that, faith of the individual will be the result of the individual. He doesn't say that if you don't follow the scripture and you do, you will incur sin. Or that you should not do, first go learn and then come back and do. He doesn't give like that. What they call, you know, a specific answer. What is it called in thinking? There is one word. It's Edward de Bono. He is famous for that. Which is not linear thinking. Which is not a specific answer. It will be open. It's a nice word for it.
Open
it. No, not open. Protect.
Lateral.
Lateral thinking. Lateral thinking. See, it won't be one particular solution. The solution will be innovative, will be different in that particular context. So Krishna doesn't give one solution. He explains, first he explains what is the importance of faith. Because somebody says, I am doing, but I don't know, but I am doing with faith. Then, but what? You may say it is faith, but what is that faith? So first he defines faith. Not defines, he explains about faith. Then he categorizes that faith is of three types. And based on what is the quality of your faith will be the result. Whether you know the scripture, don't know the scripture, in this situation you have already said, I don't know the scripture and I am acting out of faith, then what is the quality of that faith? Based on that will be your result. And the solution is go learn the scripture and then follow the instruction, then the result will be whatever the result. Here it is that he said, I don't know, but I am acting out of faith. So now we explain what are the three types of faith. So this chapter is also called Shraddha Traya Vibhaga Yoga. A chapter which is of the threefold faith. And this Shraddha is what he extends in all the other aspects of life also in this chapter. So he will explain three types of faith, which then extends into three types of tapas, three types of yajna, three types of ahar, then three types of dan. All that he explained. So, Vinoba Bhave called this chapter as Program Yoga. If you want to know practical tips, Gita in daily life, Gita in practice, all those practical tips of how to start following the Gita are there in this chapter. So, he calls it as Program Yoga, Karyakram Yoga, Karma Yoga, Bhakti Yoga, Raja Yoga, Dhyan Yoga, like that. There are many yogas in the Gita. Broad division are these four, Karma Yoga, Dhyan Yoga, Raja Yoga and Bhakti Yoga. There is Abhyas Yoga, there is Moderation Yoga, this is Karyakram Yoga, Program Yoga. Specific programs are given here, that how to follow. So if I don't know the scripture, at least I should know what are these three gunas. Because I am affected by the three gunas. And according to the three gunas, from where I am, I have to lift myself to the sattvic level. Then the purpose of the scripture is served. Otherwise, if I act out of ignorance and I am not trying to bring myself to the sattvic level, what is the purpose of doing that activity, that worship or that action will not serve its purpose. So hence he explains everything in three gunas. So now he starts with the answer of Bhagavan is very nice. He starts by saying, Trividha Bhavati Shraddha Dehinam Sa Swabhavaja. There are three types of faith, O Arjuna. Sattviki Rajasi Tamasi Chaiva. सात्विक श्रद्धा, राजसिक श्रद्धा एंड तामसिक श्रद्धा. Now, before he goes to explain what these three are, very powerful line is Sattvanurupa sarvasya shraddha bhavati bharata. Each one's fate is according to their own nature. Shraddha mayoyam purusha. A man is what his fate is. Yoyat shraddha sa evasa. One is as one's fate is. You must say, "Arey, what is this? I don't have faith in anything. I don't have faith in God. I don't have faith in the higher. I am a non-believer." But Gita says everybody has faith. There is nobody who doesn't have faith. Only difference is, where is my faith? Faith is a source of strength. Faith is an antidote to fear. Whenever I want to achieve anything and I want to have inner strength, my faith only will be my inner strength. It may be faith in myself, it may be faith in God, it may be faith in my contacts, my power, whatever, some source of faith, my money, my qualification, anything. So faith is something which is the inner source of strength. Faith is that secret fuel which will push the person to achieve anything great. That extra energy that one requires to achieve anything great, because many obstacles also will come. Why should I still carry forward? What will give me that courage to move ahead? That I can achieve it. The faith in the goal, the faith in myself, etc. Those are the things which give that extra energy to go. And Hanumanji had faith in his own abilities as well as that the Lord's work and doings, that selflessness he has. So the impossible task of crossing the ocean also he is able to achieve. Because that Shraddha is very strong. So for a spiritual seeker especially, Shraddha is most crucial. Because it is not possible to reach that Supreme without Shraddha. So each one has faith. A materialist has faith in materials, in the enjoyment, in the things, in the objects. Somebody has faith in money, somebody has faith in some people. Somebody has faith in their own name. They don't have faith in Bhagavan's name, but their own name they have faith. Mera naam bol dena, bol dena. But it's saying say ki Bhagavan ka naam lo ho jayega, are kya ho jayega? Ram Ram japte se ho jayega. But they have faith in their name. Ye kaise likha hai na? Ho jayega. So one has faith. Different people have faith in different things, but there is nobody who doesn't have faith. So one aspect is faith is a source of strength. Second aspect is the faith is that secret energy that is required to achieve anything higher. Third is, faith is always in the unknown and the unseen. Faith is required because of the unknown and the unseen. Do you need to have faith that you have a nose? It's a fact, no, it's there, you can perceive. If something is available for perception, faith is not required. There is a direct valid means of knowledge to the hand. Then why, where faith is required? Where I don't know. Like I don't know the future. I need faith that whatever happens, I will be able to handle it. That faith in myself I need to have. I don't know what result will come. Then I must have faith. Everybody comes and wishes me on the marriage day, wish you a happy marriage, but I must have faith that my marriage will be happy. Then I get into that act of marriage. Today a lot of people don't want to marry because Shraddha is not there. And they think also, oh, this one person had to live for whole life. How sad. Yeah. Faith is not there. In the unknown, there always faith will be for the unknown. Spiritual life definitely. What today one doesn't know the Supreme Self. So one definitely needs faith that it's the Self exists. And the scripture is a path which will lead me to that and I myself am able to do it, I can follow and reach that state. Majority doesn't even feel like that. It's a night of myself. How will I do? From non-belief to belief to faith is a big, 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 big journey. Lot of stages one has to go through. But once one comes to faith, then nobody can shake that person. Till one comes to faith, it is shaky. Belief can be shaken. So when people say my faith is blind, faith cannot be blind. Belief is blind. If you remember, we have done this earlier. The definition of faith is belief reinforced with conviction is faith. So if you want to write in form of equation, it is belief plus logic plus experience is equal to faith, which this belief, logic and experience will lead to firm conviction, that will be faith. So when he says here that I don't know the scripture but I am following with faith, that itself means that the person has come to a certain level. But whether it is really faith, that one has to test. And what is the quality of that faith also is important. Somebody has faith in such negative belief pattern and they go full on into that action. They have faith, but the quality of that faith is not right. That's why Bhagavan describes the faith in three levels, sattva, rajas and tamas. Tamasic faith somebody has, that if I kill those who are not belonging to my religion, I will get heaven. Now that is a faith, but it's a completely tamasic faith, which will destroy oneself, destroy others. That person also acting out of faith only. That's why a blanket yes or no cannot be said. That if you have faith and if you are acting, is it good? Yes. No. What is the quality of that faith is very important. Somebody has faith that money can get you anything. Everything is purchasable. And that is rajasic faith. How you cannot purchase love of people, you cannot purchase respect, you cannot purchase trust, you cannot purchase commitment. Other things you can purchase. And if somebody is available for sale, they will sell themselves also. But these true things and these valuable things cannot be bought, no matter how much money is given. And that is rajasic faith. Faith in that fact, in that thought that anything is purchasable. Then there is sattvic faith. Faith in the higher, faith in the path, faith in the mantra. Sattvic faith, that you will lead me there. So each one has a faith. This line is very powerful. If we are here in Gita and practice, one should examine where is my faith. In the time of difficulty, what will my mind go to? That will indicate to a certain extent where my faith is. When I am in trouble, where does my mind go to? What does the mind seek as a source of solace and strength? Does it go to Bhagavan? Does it go to some person? Does it go to one's own self? Where does it go? In crisis, that will clearly show where the faith is. At other times, also one can test one's faith even other times. Because what one has faith in, one will value that and one will want to attain that. So faith actually determines my vision of life, which further determines my desires, thoughts, actions, results. My whole life is determined by my faith. If my faith is, life is meant for enjoyment, but I will do everything only directed by that vision that life is for enjoyment. Because my faith is, that's the purpose of life. If my faith is, no, selflessness is to be cultivated in human life. I am here to serve. Then my whole vision of life is oriented like that. My action, thought, everything is oriented to that. Hence, the deepest level of a person's personality is the faith, the known level. Otherwise, the deepest is the self, which is one's own true nature. But the known, what is known is, that's why in the Gita it is said, don't disturb the faith of a person. Don't break the faith of a person. To break the faith of somebody is a very big harm to that person. Just imagine what we are suffering in this country even today because our faith was broken. 1500 years, not few years, 1500 years. And we should not blame outside people, we should blame ourselves only. Why was our faith so weak? In one way the faith was weak, it got broken, but in another way the faith continued to remain. That also is a strength only. How many temples were erased, destroyed? How many people were killed? If they talk about genocide, there is no greater genocide than which has happened in India. How many people? In the name of religion. Finished. And one temple which is belong, where we have a right, if you try to erase that and build something there with harmony, saying we will build a mosque for you nearby, my God, what a approach. How many temples were erased? And how many people's lives, how they were killed? You know, if you just go to history and you read the history of the Sikh, just the Sikh community, hair will stand on the end, the way they have been tortured. But the strength with which they stood up against the Mughals. Yesterday, 2-3 days back, I read one life of one person, Banda Bahadur. My God, what they did, how they had treated him. In front of him, they made his son sit in his lap. And they cut out the heart of his son and they put it in his mouth. Can you believe what kind of atrocity that is? And this man was strong, he didn't yield. Guru Gobind Singh, both the children were buried alive. What all has happened in this country? But on one hand it is the faith which has protected. On the other hand, it is also that the faith of the weak has got destroyed, because they came with that strategy that if you destroy the temples, the faith of the people is in their gods, in their temples, destroy them, you can control them. And they did that. What did the British do? They removed Sanskrit. One simple strategic move, removed Sanskrit from education system and introduced the translations with such manipulations that when you read the translation of the Veda by the British, by the German Max Müller, you will wonder what is this Veda. Intellectuals will lose respect for the Veda. So the faith again is shaken up. Today Hindus only go around talking nonsense about their own culture because their faith has been destroyed. Biggest damage, there you can finish off a civilization at the physical level and they will still grow. In few years they will come back. But you destroy the faith of somebody and the whole generation and a civilization, it may take centuries to come up. That's what has happened. And till today, even today, so many things are written against the culture. The only culture which gives absolute freedom to do what you want to do and still remain in the faith is the Hindu culture. But what all happens in the name of systematic attack to destroy the faith. So if you want to destroy somebody, find out their faith, attack their faith, make them completely vulnerable. They become vulnerable if their faith gets destroyed. You can finish them off. And that's what happens. So many people who have faith in the Lord, they will talk to some non-believers, and the non-believers are so strong in their thinking, they will come and talk left, right, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and this believer is like shaken up. Are bhai bhagwan hai ki nahi? Because that belief was not faith actually, that belief was very weak and got shaken up. So a man is what his faith is. So I must find out where is my faith, and is my faith strong enough that it can withstand any challenges or provocations. Very important. Forget outside challenges and provocation. One's own doubts are one's biggest enemies. Somewhere there will be one doubt. I am worshipping, but pata nahi Bhagwan hai ki nahi. That one's own self doubt is there. Pata nahi main pahunchunga ki nahi. Those doubts remain. Those one has to remove. So, having said this, now he goes ahead to describe what is the Shraddha. So he says, Yajande Sattvika Devam Yaksha Rakshamsi Rajasaha. Those who are Sattvic people, they will worship the Devtas, meaning the higher forces, the phenomenal forces, or the Lord. Because Arjun used the word worship, Bhagavan is giving the example of worship. You can apply this in any action. Yaksha Rakshamsi Rajasaha. Yaksha, Kinnara, Gandharva, there is one category of people who are, they are divine beings. They can bless you with powers, wealth, music, prosperity. They can tell you future also. If you have a Yaksha for yourself, that Yaksha can tell you what is going to happen. In Mahabharata and all, you will find there are instances of that. There are special vidyas also to own a yaksha. Like you own a car, you own an iPhone, you say, I have a yaksha. You may believe or not in all this, but all this exists. But in Hindu culture, say yaksha, you will not believe. But somebody from outside will say, you have a guardian angel. And your angel is like this, and your angel is like that. Then you will believe, one angel is there. So, yaksha, it means they categorize those rajasic level of beings who will bless you with power, money, whatever, material thing. And then, pretam bhuta ganas chanye. Those who are tamasic, they will worship pretam bhuta, this asuric and lower type of creatures, these beings. So, using this language of that time, Arjuna is being explained. In today's language, what does this mean? There are a few things to learn here. First thing to learn is, as my nature, so will be my altar. As my altar, so will be my surrender. Everyone has to know. And as my surrender, that will be my state. So as in my nature, if my nature is sattvic, my altar also will be sattvic. Here it is devatas. So one will worship whichever type of peaceful deities, you know, Krishna, Rama, all that, Shiva, Devi, some deity will be sattvic deity. If my nature is very rajasic, my deity also will be rajasic. So I may worship Indra, Varuna, all these, Kuber, Navagraha, depending on my nature, what do I want, my ambition, my desire. And if my nature is tamasic, then I will worship all this, do black magic, tantra, some of those things. So my altar is determined by my nature. As my nature, so my altar. As my altar, that will be my surrender. And whatever I have surrendered to, that is my state. I mean, that is what I absorb. That's what I become. The Siddhanta of Upasana or worship is whatever I worship, that I will become. So if I worship sattvic deities, those sattvic qualities will come into me. I will internalize those. So worship here does not mean only formal ritualistic worship. Worship here also, the second aspect here is the worship also means what I revere and what I seek. So if I revere sattvic qualities and I strive to attain those through my day, then that's what I am worshipping. It need not be only formal ritualistic worship. If my goal is selfless and I am here to serve and that's my attitude, then every act of mine is a sattvic worship. Same way, if my goal is to gain more and more money, power, position, and for that I contact those type of people and I have some setting and I am worshipping that. If my goal is to hurt, harm, destroy and through that gain some sort of supremacy or gain some sort of control or some power, then that's my order of worship. It can happen at small scale, it can happen at large scale, that all depends on what one is striving for. But in the quality, it is tamas or rajasic or sattvic. So when Bhagavan says this, that there are these three types of people dependent on their temperament, very important is to know that the nature of a person can influence the fate, and the fate of the person also can transform the nature. They have a that type of a connection. It is not one leads to the other. Each influences the other. So if my nature is rajasic, I may be tempted to have a rajasic altar. But for some grace of the Lord, some punya I have done and I have come to, let us say, satsang or some good influence. And my altar has, somehow I have come to have a sattvic altar. Slowly, my nature also will transform and satraguna will come. So my altar can change my nature. My nature will influence me to choose my altar. They both go hand in hand. And that's why it is very important to identify what should be my altar of surrender. Hanumanji, as long as he served Sugreev, his altar of surrender was rajasic. Because Sugreev himself is insecure. So the power of Hanumanji also, which manifested, was very little. But when he surrendered to Lord Ram, the altar of surrender became sattvic. Now what happened? Unlimited potential manifest. So I should check what is my altar of surrender. What is my relationship with that altar of surrender? That is also important. That when I am worshipping that altar or that Lord or that whatever is my goal there, what do I want to become? What do I want to imbibe? That is called being worshipping with Shraddha. One may not know the scripture, but this is called worshipping with Shraddha. But if one is doing either of this, then one is that category where one is not knowing the scripture, one is not even doing Shraddha, just mechanically something one is doing. Still it is better than doing absolutely nothing. Some samskar is being laid down in the mind. But it is about being conscious of what one is doing. So three types of Shraddha Bhagavan explained. This you can apply even in friendship. So many people send you their friend request on Facebook. And to identify, go to their profile, find out is this sattvic person, then say accept. Sometimes rajasic also, okay, accept it. But tamasic, delete the request. You can apply this everywhere. Sattvic, rajasic, tamasic, based on the nature, the faith, one chooses the altar of surrender. So if I want to achieve something, especially the higher things, then the sattvic route is the best route. Sometimes it may appear tedious also, difficult also, but that's the best thing. Shortcuts will be rajasic, can land in trouble. And harmful and hurtful ways are the tamasic ones. Somehow do something and reach. One can't escape the karma. So having said this, Bhagavan goes on to explain that these people who don't know the Shastra, but they say with faith they are doing, sometimes they don't even follow with that proper faith. They land up doing the wrong things because they are deluded. So that quality of that faith. So he says now about tapas, he explains now. That there are people who torture themselves. You see this. This fifth verse, he says, Ashastra vihitam ghoram. When they don't know the scripture, they do ghor tapas, meaning very austere and very sometimes painful also. Tapyanti ye tapo janaha. Why do they do it? Dambha ahankara samyukta. Because of ego. They want to prove something, gain some glory. Kamaraga balanita. They are not pushed by some selfless desire to serve the Lord or to purify the mind. But kama and raga, by selfishness and attachment. What does this mean? This tapas, he will explain proper sharirik, manasik and vachik tapas later on. But when it is in the context of worship, worship has to be such that it will help the person to purify the mind. Then that is really worship. That is sadhana. But if that mind is going to deal with rajas and tamas, rajas is kama and raga. They push themselves. So many people do, know, sometimes one does a lot of things for glory, not because of genuine desire to purify the mind or to master the senses or the mind. So it can include many things. Charity also is done for dhamma. This austerity, like 1 year I will not eat ice cream. And go on explaining every day, you know, I'm practicing. I'm not even touched. No sugar in me. No one explains. From spiritual standpoint, the ego is getting boosted. Even the mentioning as a matter of fact is a different thing. There are some people who will do upvas. So many days of upvas. Not because genuinely they are taking the name of the Lord, but one wants to establish one record. In this family, I have done maximum upvas. Bhagavan says this is dhamma, mana, kama, raga, all these. This is not to condemn, but this is to explain that these also are there. So just because one doesn't know the Shastra, whatever one is doing doesn't get sanctioned. Yeah, that is fine, just because you have faith. The faith may not be in that spiritual principle, faith is in the recognition that is coming through. That if I do this, lot of people do like that. No? If I do this, people will consider I am a very charitable person. So much of social service also many times happens as for eye wash only. It doesn't happen because genuinely there is a need. On one hand, one is exploiting the people. On the other hand, one is doing some social service. And really sometimes people believe that all the papa they have done will get cleansed by doing some donation or some charity or some Ganga Snan or some Tirtha Yatra. They think if Bhagwan Ledger has banking system like it, our human beings, 100 rupees papa, 200 rupees punya, so net balance is 100 rupees punya. No, it doesn't work like that. Mind does not work like that. No? Each and every impression has an impact. So now he goes on to even condemn the tamasic type of worship. And something very powerful he says here. So the sixth verse he says, Karshayanta Sharirastham, torturing the body, torturing somebody in the body. Who is that somebody? Bhutagramam Achetasaham. All the five elements of which this body is made, they torture this body like anything. Whom are they torturing actually? Not the body. Mam Chaiva. They are actually torturing me, who is indwelling in their body. Mamchevan Antasharirastham. I am in their body, I am the indweller in that body, I am the lord of their heart, I am the pure consciousness. And they go on torturing this body. Tan Vidhi Asura Nishtayan. Bhagavan calls them, they are asuras, who go on torturing their body, not realizing that the indweller is the Atman. And by torturing the body, one will never realize the self. No matter how much one tortures the body, self cannot be realized. Same thing Bhajagovindam also Shankaracharya said. That verse where he says, they roast themselves in the hot sun. They don't have enough clothes. And in the night they sit huddled with their face in their palms. Ratra uchuduka samarpita dhyanam. Karatala bhiksha tarutala vasa. They will have food only which comes, which fits into their palm. Only that much food. Karatala bhiksha tarutala vasa. They will stay below the tree. They will not take bath. They will torture themselves. Tapas is different from torture. Where mindlessly one goes on torturing oneself. Bhagavan says that is torturing me, the indweller. Why are you doing that? They are asuras. Better will be if one is not able to sit down quietly. Instead of torturing oneself, one should go and do karma yoga. Do some service to the society. Exhaust one's rajoguna and dynamism in making something for the society, doing something for the people, rather than just torturing oneself. So if I don't have the sattvic level of meditation, contemplation, at least I should not torture myself. Now you may say, well, what about these great rishis, people like Valmiki, you know, this whole ant hill was built on him. Did he not torture? He didn't torture himself. He had the capacity to sit quietly and take the name of the Lord, and he lost himself so deep into contemplation that no awareness only of the body. You may say, what about Ramakrishna? He doesn't eat also. Days on end he is in Samadhi. Aray, but those are examples of super sattvic level where they have no body consciousness only. We are not talking about that. Here is where people torture themselves at the physical level, thinking that this will lead them to some power or this will please the Lord. Bhagavan very clearly says, you are torturing me, I am the indweller. The faster one realizes this, the better one will take the moderate path. Buddha also tried the same thing. He lived in the palace. Then the day he got Vairagya, he left. And he tried many things. It was not working. So he said, now I am just going to torture this body. So he stopped eating. If you see some of the paintings and some of the depictions of Buddha, there is one picture of Buddha where he is completely only bones. You can even see the ribs. Completely emaciated. He thought that maybe by that one will attain salvation. Nothing happened. So that's when he finally came to the middle path. He said, this doesn't work, torture doesn't work, living in absolute indulgence, that doesn't work. One has to follow the middle path. So this is that tamasic type of worship, where one worships by torturing oneself. See, to get out of body identification, there is some amount of self-control that one requires. There is no doubt in that. That is not what is meant here by Bhagavan. Here the torture is of a very different kind.
There are some groups which going on in the body, said they put the, you know, those iron rods on their body.
Torture only that. Put the rod through the mouth, pull the cart by, you know, pinning that
hair, with the hair with
you, you know, behind. Every culture has. There is no culture which has not had that. Because it's a part of the evolution of human being, where somebody will try that method being very frustrated, that body identification is not going, let me try something. And somebody has tried it, not found it useful and dropped it, but other fellows are continuing. Because some notion goes around that if you do this, this particular desire of yours will be fulfilled. Lots of people do it for desire. They walk on fire. And there are those tamasic worship forms which are to please the certain demigods also. So you please this particular devata or this yaksha or this something, and then you get some benefit. All that also is there. It doesn't. It is not there. It is all there. But where will it lead to? The realization that one wants, that doesn't come. Those who want that, they will get that. At a point in time, one will evolve out of it. And somewhere human being loses the purpose. See, one of the meaning, one of the important part is that only. Time and again, this act, this revival of the culture has to happen. Even what is written in the scripture, if it is not adapted to the present time, it will become outdated. It will become dogmatic. In Hindu culture, it has been good that again and again and again there have been masters who have come and who have reinterpreted the scripture, retaining the essential principles and made it relevant to the community. Otherwise, it will become blindly, if we follow the scripture, it won't work. So once one understands these things, accordingly one judges, this is my faith, and then thus. Now he goes on to explain about food. Now we will speak about food, and then the yajna, and then the tapas, all in three categories. So the word worship in the first question of Arjun, Bhagavan extends to all the different types of activities. And he says, whatever you do, if you are not following it because as written in the Shastra, and if you say it is because of my faith I am just following, then examine your faith in the worship, in your activities, in your food, in the type of austerity you do, in all this. And that's why he is explaining everything in three categories. So now comes the food part. Sattvic food, rajasic food, tamasic food. So seventh verse, he actually just enlists what all he is going to explain. Ahar, yajna, tapa, dana. All this he will explain now in sattva, rajas and tamas. So what is the sattvic food? Eighth verse. This one can memorize. Verses 8, 9, 10, if one memorizes, it will help the person while making choices. So if burger comes in front of you, the rajasic shloka must come to your mind. And then you decide, should I eat or not eat? Ayu sattva bala rogya.
Ayu sattva bala rogya.
Sukha priti vivardhanaha.
Sukha priti vivardhanaha.
Rasya snigdha sthira hridyaha.
Rasya snigdha sthira hridyaha.
Ahara sattvika priyaha.
Ahara sattvika priyaha.
So what is sattvic food? See, now there are two ways to understand this aspect. What was said earlier? As per my nature, I will choose a guna. So if I want to know in what mood I am right now, to know that at the mind level what is my mood right now is subtle. But at the physical level, the hunger pain which comes, at that point, what does the mind want to eat, that shows the mood of the mind. So when I am feeling hungry, my mind says, eat some fruit. That means the mind has succumbed. If the mind says, go and take up some hot, what is it? Pizza. And go and eat. It's hungry for chatpatas food. Then that means the mood is rajasic. And if one says, get one high, mood is tamasic. So through the choice of the food, I can understand what is my mood of mind. That is that's how the shlokas are given. That if these are your preferences, that means you are sattvic quality at that point in time. And if you predominantly live this way, then that is your quality. That's a good thing. So according to the preference of food, you can know the mood of the mind. And the other way also, if your mood of the mind is like this, that's how you will prefer. So now what is the sattvic thing? Ayuhu, food which will strengthen these four things. What it will strengthen? Strengthen your age, longevity basically. You have to use words which are used by dietitians nowadays. You eat these type of foods, you live long, longevity. Ayuhu. Then, sattva. Sattva here means purity, which will increase the purity of the mind. Ayuhu sattva. Bala, it will strengthen the body. And arogya, it will keep the body free from diseases. Ayuhu sattva bala arogya. Oh, fifth one is also there. Seven aspects are there. Sukha, it will increase your happiness. True happiness, not the pleasure of the tongue. You feel very happy when you eat that. Because it is nutritious for the body, it is healthy for the body. Not the excitement of the tongue and that's why I feel very happy. Not that. It really makes the body also happy. And Preeti. Sukha and Preeti. Preeti means love. Vivardhana. These type of sattvic food will increase these factors. What will they increase? Seven factors. Ayuhu, longevity, age. Then sattva, purity. Then bala, strength. Ayu sattva bala, arogya. This will not create disease in the body. And sukha, happiness. And preeti, love. Six things, not seven. Whatever increases these six, you say, well, how can food increase my love and my purity and my... But that's a fact. Because the food has direct impact on the mind. The gross part will become the body. The waste part will come out. The subtle essence of the food becomes the mind.
You are what you eat.
You are what you eat. That's a fact. There is a PJ also on that. You are what you eat. And you become what you eat. So let us eat something rich. So the point is that the food is not just the grains and the fruit and then the cooked food. It is not that. That is just the physical part. There is the subtle part of the food, which is the vitamins and minerals and whatever is the... If you remember 15th chapter, Bhagavan said, Soma Bhutva Rasatmaka. I become the Soma and I nourish the plants and the vegetables and everything. I become the sun, Yadaditya Gatam Teja. I nourish and I become the moon and I become the fertility in the earth. All those subtle aspects, that is one aspect of food. The attitude with which it is cooked, the money with which it is bought, with what attitude was that money earned? That also affects the food quality. We may not believe it today, but it is applicable. Energy works. And that's why the purification of that food happens. Before we eat the food, from where which... You know, the tree on which that particular fruit or that vegetable has grown, that also matters. And that matters in everything, not just in the food. Suppose this is made of wood, anything made up of here is wood, this is made up of wood. From which tree has this come? What is the quality of that tree? And Vastu goes to that extent of saying, ki, was there a Bhuta or Pishach also on that tree or not? That also will affect. That's why they do the Graha Pravesh and Vastu Puja and everything. We may not know the forces which are functioning, but they are functioning. Just like law of gravity functioning, we don't know. If we know, then we work according to that. Electromagnetism is there. How much are we aware of that? Cell phone radiation is everywhere. Some of us are aware of it. Many we don't even know. Where all it is there, what all levels it is there. So important point here is that the food, the subtle part of the food affects the mind, and that's why the sattvic food is this. So what are these type of food? So he gives four categories: those which are juicy, rasya, meaning fruits, vegetables, raw food; snigdha, those which are naturally lubricating, so nuts, peanut, groundnut, badam, all this one. It will produce oil. When you digest it, it will produce oil. A lot of people, all these people, they say, "Arey, you don't drink milk, then your joints will get weak." Arey, but you will get lubrication from nuts and many other things, Bhagwan. We have a conditioned thinking. If we get lubrication only from ghee and what we call oil, and if you don't eat ghee and oil, from where you will get lubrication? It will come. Like sugar, whatever we eat anyway boils down to sugar only. कुछ मीठा हो जाए, आप मीठा नहीं खाओगे, अरे नहीं खाएंगे, not required. If some jaggery or something is there, made of jaggery, one needs, but white sugar one doesn't need to eat. So rasya is the fruits, vegetables. Sthira rasya, snigdha, snigdha is the oil lubricating. Sthira, very important, that which will stabilize the body, not destabilize the body. White sugar is one of the most destabilizing things that one can ever eat. It will just throw hormones out of balance. One spoon of white sugar. You may be aware, nowadays a lot of awareness, but if you are not, you go and find out. What does one spoon of white sugar do? How does it affect the hormones? How the entire body goes into a panic mode to just digest that one spoon? And imagine concentrated doses of that sugar we drink in that carbonated drinks. How much sugar is there in that? Minimum, I think 10 to 15 spoons minimum.
8 tablespoons.
8 tablespoons. One drink. Normal carbonated drink. Then there is Red Bull and all that. Extra. Gatorade, Red Bull. It is not stabilizing. It's completely destabilizing. Sthira, food must stabilize. And if one comes to that type of organic food or whatever that is, it will stabilize. I have seen the difference, so I am talking from my little experience. From the time I left white sugar, such a relief. This up and down doesn't happen only. The mood swing doesn't happen. The hormone doesn't go up and down. Body has got stabilized. Voice has got stabilized. Otherwise voice would crack. 30 minutes, 40 minutes gone, voice crack. I'm not saying everybody who eats sugar, their voice will crack. I'm talking only from my experience. That's stabilizing. Fruits stabilize the body. And I've seen wherever fruits we don't eat, the body becomes so acidic. Again you start eating fruit, again it gets stabilized. Because our body is made alkaline. Now we are eating such type of food, and unfortunate it is that now eating such alkaline food that we have become, acidic food, that we are not capable of digesting raw food properly. So you have to boil that fruit, eat the fruit, or you know, make some simple soup and drink that. Because the body is not now used to assimilating only raw food. And if one starts eating raw immediately, pain, gas, morning trouble, motion trouble, all that happens. So, sthira, what will stabilize the body? Rasya, snigdha, sthira, and hridya, what is good for the heart? What is good for the heart? All these things only. Fruits, sprouts, vegetables, nuts, green leafy vegetables, all that, which is good for the stomach, which is good for the heart. Even what they say, omega 3 fatty acids and all that, that is all snigdha, which if you eat those walnut and all that nicely, very good. I don't know how true it is, but it's very interesting that one research which is done, that the type of food, the shape of that food affects that part of the body. walnut is like the brain, kidney beans is like the kidney, carrot is like the eye. Very interesting. Have you seen?
Yes.
I have one picture on my phone. I wanted to ask some dietitian, some doctor to find out whether it is appropriate or not before we explain. But very nice, interesting that is. But carrots are good for the eyes. So if you cut the carrot, it has that round eyeball type of a thing. Kidney beans is like that shape of the kidney only. Walnut is like the brain. Many examples like that they have. So if you want to nourish that part of the body, eat that type of food.
So carrot gives the vitamin A which is good for eyes.
Yeah. So that is sattvic food. What is rajasic food? What is tamasic food? If you want to know, come to know. Om Purnamidam Purnamidam Purnat Purnamidachate Purnasya Purnamadaya पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्ति। हरि ओम श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः।